Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, we have a full day ahead of us, and in your bulletins, you'll notice the announcements. We, right now, are still planning to go ahead with the kids and youth spring adventure today. Although, in the bulletin, it says 11:30 p.m., we're not having a midnight hike. It's 11:30 a.m., so... we're going to meet after worship in the fellowship hall and assess the situation. Ladies' Bible study, last session today, WMU meeting coming up, and the Selah event coming up on Saturday. So be in prayer for that, ladies. And on the back of your bulletin, we have a great many new prayer needs. Rudy Broderson. Praise there. He is in rehab now, doing well after his catheterization. Blanche Virginia Dameron, Rose's neighbor, is hospitalized in Fairfax. Greg Dishman has surgery for a detached retina on the 19th. Phyllis Dishman had back surgery and cancer diagnosis. Lisa Elliott in Memorial Regional Hospital with an infection. A praise for Kathy Herbert, who's doing better. Charlotte Jenkins is scheduled for back surgery on the 29th. Ed Lewis is recovering from a fractured vertebrae. Anna Ludwig has some very serious health issues. She's at VCU. Now, so please be in prayer for Paul and Anna. Wayne Packett is now at home. Wayne Packett is now at home, so that's a praise. And a praise for Teresa Russ. Her treatment for breast cancer is looking very promising, so that's a praise. Marion Sanders is at Northern Neck Senior Care, recovering from a broken pelvis. Please be a special prayer for her. That's very painful. And Jimmy Ginn is at Harmony in Mechanicsville. Those are just the new requests that want their names on the prayer list. I am sure you know about many needs and many praises that need the Lord's attentions. So let's go to Him now in prayer and start this service off right. Father, we love You. And we thank You for all that You have done. You do all things well. And Lord, I don't remember Your blessings enough. I concentrate so much on the negative that I forget the positive things, the wonderful gifts that You give every single day. Among them, Lord, we are here alive and healthy and ready to praise You this morning. Thank You. But Lord, I pray for those who are hospitalized in the hospital right now, Lord. I pray for the house fires that have happened this week for Maddie and their family. Lord, I pray for all the personal needs and worries that we brought here today. We bring them to You, and I ask that You be patient with us, that You continue to love us as only You can, and that You meet us where we are this morning. We give ourselves to You in worship. And all God's people said, Amen. We're going to sing together two songs, back to back, Blessed Be the Tie, which many of you remember, and The Family of God. Let's stand as we sing, and Cindy will guide us.
Thank you.
because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a labor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm falling, don't you catch me when I'm falling, and you told me who I am. I'm yours, I'm yours. Who am I that the eyes that see my sin would look on me with love and watch me rise again? That calm the sea would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me. Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am the flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, will you catch me when I'm falling, and you told me who I am. Because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave crossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, will you catch me when I'm falling, and you told me who I am. I'm yours. I'm yours. I'm yours. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? 'Cause I am yours. I'm yours.
Thank you. Let's pray together now from God's Word, from Psalm 148. Praise the Lord from the earth, you creatures of the ocean depths. Mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars,
wild animals and all livestock, small scurrying animals and birds,
kings of the earth and all people, rulers and judges of the earth.
Young men and young women, old men and children.
Let them all praise the name of the Lord, for his name is very great.
His glory towers over the earth and heaven.
He has made his people strong, honoring his faithful ones, the people of Israel, who are close to him.
Praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen. Brothers and sisters, we have met to worship. Let's stand as we sing.
Almighty God, we have come to this place of worship and we have gathered our hearts together and we have lifted up our voices in praise and thanksgiving for all that you do. Father, we're so blessed by you and what you've done for us. And now, Father, we just take a small portion of what you have blessed us with and return it to you and ask you to bless it and multiply it. Father, we lift up our voices at this moment in praise and thanksgiving, for we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Okay, children, come on up for the children's message. Morning. How are y'all doing? Good?
Nothing.
Oh, you'll never guess.
Pencil.
Pencil, that's a pretty good guess.
Pencil or pen?
Don't squeeze too hard. You might break it.
Pencil or pen?
Pen. I'm still waiting.
Let's see.
A bag.
Ooh, there are two things in here. So you have two chances to be right. A thermometer, yeah, you know what that is. And what's this? Yeah, it's like a little rag, a little washcloth. I want to tell you about Troy. And Troy was about your age, and he woke up one night in the middle of the night, and he felt sick to his stomach. Have you ever felt sick in your tummy, even maybe where you threw up, really sick?
Well, he
was very sick, and he had a headache, and he felt really, really hot, too. And he started calling for his mom, and his mom came and took his temperature, and he was running a fever. Have you ever heard of a fever? Fever is when your body gets too hot. It's trying to fight some kind of bug or some kind of germ inside of you. And he was sick all night, and he lost his dinner that he ate and couldn't eat anything. And his mom stayed up with him all night long. As he was in bed, she gave him some special medicine, and she took this wash rag and got it nice and cool in the sink under the water, and then would tap his head and to try to cool him down. And she stayed up all night long. And the next morning, Troy's grandma showed up, and she helped with Troy. But by that time, you know, Troy was feeling better, and he slept all day long. You know what his mom did? His mom went to work, and she felt just like you just yawned. That's how she felt all day long. She was really tired. And she came home just as Troy was waking up, and Troy said, "Mama, I'm hungry." And you know what Troy's mama did? She went in the kitchen and started making a little dinner for him. You know, and as Troy was waiting, he thought to himself, you know what? My mama looks really tired. She keeps yawning. You know, it must be because she stayed up with me all night long. She wasn't feeling sick, but she stayed up with me all night long and helped me to feel better. And then she went to work, and then she came home and started fixing dinner for me. You know, she didn't have to do that. She must really love me. And so you know what Troy did? He went into the kitchen, and he hugged his mama. And his mama said, "What's wrong, Troy?" And he said, "Mama, I just want to say thank you for helping me when I'm sick. I love you so much." You know, it's good to do that. When someone helps you, and when someone is there for you and loves you, it's good to tell them thank you sometimes and to realize how much they've done for you. And think of all that Jesus has done for you. Wouldn't it be good to tell God thank you too? Let's pray together. Lord, I pray just thanking you for all that you have done. You have been up with us all night long. You walk with us all during the day. You've even died for us in Jesus, all because we love you, and you love us, and you loved us before we even loved you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. In Jesus, amen.
Thank you.
Okay, let me test your memories. There's an old bluegrass song that you may have heard back in the day by Lester Flatt and Earl Scruggs called Give Me Flowers When I'm Living. You ever heard of that song? Give me flowers when I'm living. And of course, the whole message of the song is, don't wait until somebody's funeral to give them flowers, to be nice to them, to tell them you love them. Do it now while there's time. And I can't count the number of times I have sat down with the family at a funeral home or in their homes, and we're planning the funeral service for a father or a mother or a husband or a wife or even a child who died. And I will hear something along the lines of, I wish I had just told them that I love them. I wish I had told them how much they mean to me and how, or even just said thank you for all they've done to me. I guess I can't now. I know I've thought that sometimes with people who have exited from my life, either through death or our lives kind of went along different paths, and I wish I could go back and tell them what a difference they've made in my life. And so the question I want to ask myself and ask you this morning is, are we ingrates or greatly blessed? All the kindness that has been poured out into our lives from other people, through other people, are we ingrates? Do we just feel like it's owed to us somehow and just forget about it? Or do we experience the blessing and joy that comes from telling people what they mean to us? Not waiting until a funeral. We're in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, and we're going to start in verse 11 of 2 Corinthians 12. I don't hear many pages turning. You should be furiously turning. It's because you're already there, right? Already turned there. Amen. And the Pew Bibles, so on page 970. Paul had just unselfishly poured his life into these new Christians in the city of Corinth. Men, women, children, teenagers. He had just given of himself. He came to them when they didn't know anything about God. And he was Jesus' stand-in with them. He didn't charge them a dime. He didn't come with an agenda. He didn't want a pat on the back or to be recognized. He just came to give them Jesus, to introduce them to Jesus, then to show them what God is like by the way he lived and the way he loved them and the way he gave himself, the way he gave himself to them. And in return, he had a bunch of ingrates. People who not only didn't really stop to say, thank you, Paul. We love you, Paul. You've meant such a difference to us, Paul. Not only that, they turned against him and began to question his motives and criticize him and to wander from the gospel, the good news of Jesus, because they thought they'd found other things that were better, people that were more impressive. Charlatans who rode into town claiming to be apostles, super apostles, Paul calls them. So Paul writes them again. We know he wrote at least four letters to the church at Corinth. Two of them are actually recorded in full in the Bible. Let's read verses 11 and 12 of chapter 12. Paul says, I've been a fool. You forced me to it, for I ought to have been commended by you, for I was not at all inferior to these super apostles, even though I am nothing. The signs of a true apostle were performed among you with utmost patience, with signs and wonders and mighty works. Father God, I'm not worthy to stand here and speak your word, but I give what I am able to right now. And I pray that you will speak to me and through me. Pray that we will hear what you have to say this morning. Forgive us. Make my heart and mind ready places for your spirit. Only you can do that. We are yours. We are listening. In Christ we pray. Amen. Has someone patiently proved God's grace to you? Paul said that he was with these people patiently. He was the real deal. I mean, he was authentic. He didn't come with an agenda. He was one of these very rare people that come into your life sometimes and they are real. They're the true article. They practice what they preach. Maybe just a handful of those people you're going to run across your entire lives. Paul was that person to this church. Who is that to you? You look back over your life. Has someone patiently proved God's grace to you? They taught you who God is, not just with their mouths, but with their lives. And that time that you spent together with that person, they showed you what the grace of God looks like. Amen? They weren't looking for anything from you. They weren't looking for money. They weren't looking to be congratulated. They just loved you. And they just showed you a taste of God's grace here in this world. And if we're honest with ourselves, those people, those few people, are largely responsible for our faith right now. We stand on their shoulders. Who is that for you? Here's the action statement. The first one. Commend them. Commend them. Paul said in verse 11, I've been a fool. You forced me to it. I ought to have been commended by you. Paul feels silly that he has had to explain himself, to say, listen, I love you. I just wanted to show Christ to you. I am real. You should have been the one telling me this. I shouldn't have to defend myself. Commend them, these people who have patiently showed God's grace for you. A couple of weeks ago, I'd gotten done with the service. And we came back for the ladies' Bible study here, and Tammy was in that, and I was sitting back in my study. And I started to think about the children's sermon. That is a highlight. I'm sorry, I love preaching to you, but that's the highlight for me. It means so much to me. The entire sermon, every sermon, is in a nutshell with the kids. I suspect that some of you listen sometimes more than they do. I love to see what God's doing in their hearts, and I just to me that's so satisfying. It brings me so much joy, and I thought back over my life to Mr. D, who I thought was old as dirt, but he was younger than me when I was growing up with them. And every Sunday, Mr. D led the kids, and he gave us a children's sermon. And he used a little object or a story, and he showed me and taught me who God is. I can't remember any one story, one thing that he said. I remember some of the objects. I don't really remember how they related. But cumulatively, all of that teaching was God's grace to me and gave me my start in understanding the holiness and the love of God and what Jesus had done for me, and had set the stage of everything that I am in my faith that's good now. He gave me my first lessons of what a pastor is supposed to be, what a shepherd looks like, because he showed me Jesus. And you know what, it occurred to me, I haven't spoken to that man in 35 years. I wonder if he's still alive. He's got to be close to 90. And I made some phone calls and got a number and called him up and heard his voice, a little weaker, but clear as a bell on the other side of the phone. He remembered me. That's not a big surprise. Not because I was intelligent, but because I was just memorable. And I told him, I commended him. I told him what I was doing, what I was doing right now in my life, and how I could just take my entire, everything that's good that I've ever done as a pastor, everything that's good about the faith I have in Jesus, he taught me. And I thanked him. I don't know how he felt, but it was such a blessing to me to have the privilege to be able to tell him that, to express my gratitude. It completely changed my perspective. It was the best thing that happened to me that day. I didn't wait to give his eulogy at a funeral. I didn't wait to think, well, gee, so-and-so really meant a lot to me back then. I commended him while I could. Has someone patiently proved God's grace to you? Commend them. Has someone, rather than being another hypocrite, another person with an ulterior motive or an angle in your life, someone actually is a follower of Jesus Christ and they poured themselves into your life and showed God's grace to you, commend them. Tell them. And be blessed. Now, many of you look back over your life and you think, well, Keith, that sure would be nice, but that person's gone. They've crossed the river. They're with the Lord now. I can't go back. Well, you know, you can still commend them. You know how you can commend them? Practice what they preached. Make good on what they taught you. Be a taste of grace for someone else coming behind you. And unselfishly give yourself to them without expecting anything in return. After all, these people did that for you. Amen? Commend them. Second, has someone unselfishly invested in you? Be forgiving with them. Be forgiving with them. Now who? Think back over your life. There have been people, who are they? That have unselfishly invested in you. Not invested to turn a profit for themselves. But maybe they never experienced any rewards from your life or from you personally. But they nevertheless poured themselves into you. Spent themselves, invested themselves in you, and you have profited greatly. Who has patiently worked with you, given you another chance and another chance? Who's bears with you or has done that? Who has forgiven you? Who has with absolutely unconditional love. Love that resembles the love of God and Jesus invested in you. Be forgiving with them. Why aren't we more understanding and forgiving with people who have given us so much? You ever think about that? Now, you can almost easily understand why we're not forgiving with somebody who didn't give us anything. Someone who's mistreated us and that's all they've done. But why is it that we have such a hard time being patient and being forgiving with the people who have invested in us the most? Have you ever noticed that? Yesterday in the morning, I got up and I thought, you know, I have lots of things to do, but I need to get some exercise, and I'm just going to do something for fun today. I'm going to go play disc golf. And I'm not going to explain what that is. If you don't know, it's throwing a frisbee around like golf, okay? And so I took my phone up and checked the weather app, because nobody wants to play golf in the driving rain, right? And checked my weather app, and thunderstorms all day long, it said. I was like, great. Well, I guess I'll stay home and work on my sermon and be with my wife, and that's wonderful. I was sitting down for lunch, and I looked outside and saw the sun and saw how beautiful it was outside, and I thought to myself, what gives? What is going on here? Is the weatherman completely off his rocker? I mean, and I looked at my weather app, this time with my glasses on. The location, the home location, was Ecuador. So they had a terrible day yesterday in Ecuador. Just rained all day long. Meanwhile, Calio was great. But my weather app was in the wrong location. Now, sometimes our minds are completely in the wrong location when it comes to people. We're thinking about what these people have done to us, how they've fallen short, how they don't do right, they're not perfect, what they should have done, but they didn't. Our minds are in Ecuador, and we're missing out on the clear, beautiful blessings of what God is doing through them right now. Because all we're doing is focusing on where they fall short, and we miss the face of Jesus. We miss heavenly visitations through the people that love us and endure us every day. Verses 13 and 14. Paul says, "For in what were you less favored than the rest of the churches, except that I myself did not burden you?" Paul, when he went to other churches, they kind of, you know, would come in on Sunday and they're worshiping, and they would give him a little bit from their earnings so that he could stay among them and cover his expenses. He didn't do that when he went to Corinth. He worked for himself. He was bivocational. He made tents during the day and prayed while he was doing it, and then came and gave himself to them, didn't collect a thing from them. He says in verse 13, "Forgive me this wrong." Yes, that is sarcasm. You could just feel the hurt. "I didn't do anything to you except not burden you. Oh, please forgive me for that." Here he says, "For the third time, I am ready to come to you. I'm gonna clear my schedule, and I'm gonna come to you again. And you're not paying my way." He says, "For children," he says, "I seek not what is yours, but you." He didn't want anything from them. He wanted what was best for them. "For children are not obligated to save up for their parents, but parents for their children." He asked them sarcastically, "Would you cut me some slack? Would you forgive me my many sins?" But you know, There is an element of truth in that. Someone could invest themselves in us and give us so much, be a blessing from the Lord, and yet we obsess. Our minds are in Ecuador when we obsess about their shortcomings and refuse to forgive them. Why? Why did the Corinthians do that to Paul? Well, they forgot about how much he'd done for them. They just forgot. They had spiritual amnesia. Why? Why do we lose patience? Why do we resent some of these people who have invested so much in us? We forget how much they have done for us over the years. How much they've poured themselves into our lives. Are we entitled to that? Are we just so awesome that they should fall at our feet? And no, but we forget. We don't consider what they've been through. These critics in Corinth didn't consider what Paul had been through. Writing letters on tear-stained parchment. Paying his own way, spending whatever savings he could get together to try to help them. And they were well off. He gave the best years of his life, literally, there in Corinth. He stayed longer there than he did any other city, any other churches that he worked in. Poured himself into them, and yet they snipe at him and say things like, well, you know, so-and-so can preach a lot better than Paul. Yeah, so-and-so, you know, they seem to have better credentials and are a lot more impressive than him. Oh, he's collecting this love offering for Jerusalem. What does he want to keep some of it himself? And they have this bitter, resentful, fault-finding mindset. Their minds are in Ecuador, and they're missing out on the grateful joy that comes from forgiving someone in your heart. They took Paul for granted. They feel entitled. And they expected him to conform to their perfect ideals of what an apostle was supposed to look like. Now, the problem with perfect ideals, whether it's the perfect ideal of what a husband or wife should act like, or what a child should be like, or what a preacher should be like, or what a boss at work is supposed to be like, the problem with perfect ideals is that human beings cannot achieve those perfect ideals. Even Jesus, when he came and walked among us, a perfect man, the only perfect man that has ever existed on planet Earth, people found fault aplenty with him because he didn't match their perfect ideas because their minds weren't right and they were not forgiving. Who are the people who have unselfishly invested in you? One of the marks of maturity, one of the signs of growing up in your minds and in your hearts is to be able to forgive people who have loved you and done the best they could. Can I get an amen on that? I mean, growing up, and as a young man, I bitterly resented certain people. And as my life unfolded and I lived life myself and realized how far I fell short, I looked back and thought, you know, they did an amazing job, probably better than me. I was wrong to have been so resentful to them. In fact, I am grateful. I am grateful for the way they invested in me. Amen? Now, what about people who you probably should be more forgiving with and more understanding with because they've invested so much in you, but now the opportunity is passed because they've exited stage left? Maybe they've died or they're no longer part of your life. What can we do? Well, I can be forgiving with others. If I look back and I see someone that I held a grudge with far too long when that person actually loved me and they were just being a human being like me, the best thing I can do to be more forgiving with them now is to be more forgiving with someone else for their sake. Amen? And I have a third question. Has someone sacrificed for your soul? Has someone sacrificed for your soul? Who? Who's done that? Who has made sacrifices? I've mentioned many times some of those people from the pulpit. I think back about those poor children's volunteers and RA leaders when I was growing up. I think of my poor parents and what they had to deal with. Think about all these people who sacrificed day after day, week after week, year after year, for my soul. Not because of anything they were ever going to get out of Keith Williams, but because they just loved me and wanted me to be safe in the arms of Jesus. They wanted me to know Jesus and for my soul to be saved. And they told me about God patiently. They worked with me. They refused to give up on me. And they kept on, and they kept on, and they kept on. I mean, everyone here who calls yourself a Christian had somebody who told you about Jesus. Amen? I didn't get enough amens on that. There's somebody here who just came up with that on your own. God visited you out of the blue and said, let me tell you about my son Jesus. No, not one here. Someone, even if it was a writer of Scripture, shared Jesus with you and then showed you Jesus in some small way or some big way. And more than that, people sacrificed their time. People sacrificed their finances. People sacrificed their peace of mind. They patiently endured our nonsense to show us Jesus. Well, show them Christ's love. If they showed you Jesus, if they sacrificed for your soul, show them Christ's love. Look at verse 15. Listen to Paul's heart of sacrifice when he says, I will most gladly spend and be spent for your souls. He's not talking about money. He's talking about himself. He's willing to be spent until he's empty if that's what it takes to save their souls. He's willing and he has already sacrificed, and he's writing this letter right now to people who've kicked him back in the face, but he hadn't given up on them. He's willing to sacrifice his pride. He's willing to sacrifice a bunch of aggravation. He's willing to sacrifice a bunch of ink and prayers and tears for their souls. And what would be nice in return? Love. He says, if I love you more, am I to be loved less? He doesn't want anything from them. He wants them. The love of Christ to be shown in them. But granting, verse 16, that I myself did not burden you, I was crafty, you say. They called his motives into question. He's kind of talking about their accusations. And got the better of you by my deceit. Did I take advantage of you through any of those whom I sent to you? The answer is, of course, no. I didn't. Show them Christ's love. As Christians, there are blessings of God that come into your life. Those blessings are people. Paul was an apostle. You know what the word apostle means? Apostolos just means sent. Sent. Paul was literally sent by God to these people. Sent to show them God's love, to show them God's grace, to show them who the Lord is and all His patience and His mercy. And there have been people sent, heaven sent, literally into your life, and they have given and sacrificed to make sure you know about Jesus. When you stand before the judgment seat of Christ, you will not be able to say, it will not stand in court to say to God, God, I never knew about you. All I got was a bunch of hypocrites. I never had anyone love me. I never had anyone give up anything for me. I never had anyone patiently work with me or give me a second chance. All God will have to do will say, I sent this one, and I sent this one. Look how they sacrificed. Look how they loved. Look how they gave, and they did it for me, and they did it for you. You do not have an excuse. And when I think about it, about the question of who has patiently showed God's grace to me, who has unselfishly invested in me, and who has sacrificed for my soul, you know, there's one person that stands out above every other. His name is Jesus. What more could He have done for me? He was sent, heaven sent for me, and He gave. He didn't just give a tenth of His patience. He didn't give a tenth of His time. He gave it all. He gave His very life for me. And all, even when I was an ingrate, even when I didn't have an ounce of love for God, Jesus came and gave everything for me. Oh, what can I do? What can I do? Well, I can love Him. I can give myself what little I am to Him. He doesn't want what I could give to Him. He wants me. And that's what I can give. It's the only response that's appropriate. It's my reasonable act of worship, as Romans 12, 1 through 2 describes it, to give my life as a living sacrifice to God. And the best way of doing that sometimes is to pay it forward to somebody else. Amen? If you and I can't look at our lives and see people that we are pouring ourselves into for Jesus, we're not making disciples. We're not following the Great Commission. We're not being faithful Christians if we try to hold God's grace to ourselves instead of pouring it out to others. Let it live on. Let it grow. Be blessed. Experience the wonderful joy and satisfaction and fulfillment that comes from giving. You think getting is good? It doesn't have anything on giving. You get, when you give God, you can't outgive Him. He gives you even more in return. Father God, we give ourselves to You. Maybe there's someone here this morning who believes certain things about You. Oh, I believe God exists. Oh, yes, I go to church sometimes. Oh, yes, my mom and dad were Christians, definitely. And all the while, looking at our lives, we've been ingrates. We have forgotten what You've done. We have forgotten those who You have sent. We have spurned Your patience. And Lord, now the time has come, like these Corinthians, where we need to stop, turn around, and thank You with our lives. Lord, You've saved our souls. Now save our lives. Give us the ability to change and to pour ourselves out now into others. If there's someone here who needs to entrust themselves to You, to become Christians by giving themselves to You, may they pray with me right now. Father, I have been ungrateful. I've been self-centered. I've been prideful. I understand that. I'm sorry. forgive me by the blood of Jesus Christ. I don't understand that kind of love, but I trust you. And now, Lord, I give myself completely to you in Jesus. Come and live within me and by your Holy Spirit and make me a changed man or a woman as I begin to walk with you. And Lord, for that person that you have brought to my mind and heart many times, give me endurance and patience and determination to keep on loving, keep on praying, keep on hoping, keep on giving, and to be blessed in doing so. Thank you for those who have done that for us. May we show that thanks. In Christ we pray, amen. Let's stand as we sing, Footsteps of Jesus. You come as the Lord leads. Father, now as we go from here, may we follow you and walk in your footsteps. Thank you. Thank you, thank you for all you have done, are doing, and will do for us. And Lord, thank you for giving us another chance to show our gratitude today with those we love, with those that are difficult, and even with ourselves. May we show the grace of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen. Thank you. Thank you.